So, hello everyone. I am Buster Benson, and I'm really excited to talk to you all about disagreement and this weird thing that we generally try to avoid, or we generally try to find really unpleasant. But I want to talk about a way to shift your mindset about it a little bit, to use it as a way to actually enjoy life more. So I'm really excited to hear how y'all respond to this. I'm open for questions anytime, and there will be a lot of discussion points along the way. But quick intro of myself. I have two boys. One just turned 10 last week, and one is going to be 4 in a couple months, so he's 3.5. And you know, like you guys, we've been, you know, staying at home, like doing school at home, and it's been a really great time to just like reconnect with them. My career over the last 20 years has been in the tech world. So I was at Amazon, I was at Twitter, I was at Slack, and I was building teams to build products, so releasing features and working with engineers and designers and doing all that stuff. But my main part of my job was like helping everyone get along so that, you know, we can actually focus on doing meaningful work instead of just, you know, arguing about stuff. So then most recently, I wrote a book called Why Are We Yelling? The Art of Productive Disagreement, which distills all of this stuff down to something that's not only useful for work, obviously, but also for at home, for your relationships with your parents, with your siblings, just like getting along in the world, because it's just something that we all just end up doing, you know, throughout our lives, is disagreeing with each other. And might as well get better at it, right? It's not going to go away. All right, so let me actually turn this on to present. Does this still stick around when I go to present?
Yep.
Okay. So, all right. So most of the time, the biggest shift I want to start with is we see the world through our disagreements. Like it's like we don't see how we're disagreeing. What we see is that we feel the anger. We see the things that are right and wrong in the other person's argument, and we are really critical of other people in this state, but we are less critical of ourselves, and we're less aware of what we're doing through this process of disagreement. And we refine the skill in ourselves mostly through trial and error, either by copying people that, you know, we're around, or by trying things and seeing what works, or seeing what doesn't work and just avoiding that forever. I really want us to think about, you know, how do we look at the disagreement? How do we look at the world through this lens, but also look at the lens, right? Because the lens is this thing that we use to see the world, but we don't actually check our glasses all the time and see, like, is there a fly on the glass? Is this glass cracked? Is it not working correctly? Am I seeing things in a warped way? And when emotions are concerned, obviously we are seeing things in a warped way. Not necessarily, I mean, and that's unavoidable, but we can at least look at it and think about it. So let's see here. I want to start with, what is a disagreement? Because that's the first thing that I think a lot of us get wrong. Let's see here, let me talk smaller. Okay, so how many people do you think it takes to have a disagreement?
Two.
Two? Yeah, is it always two?
No, two or more.
It could be two or more. Could it be one?
Yes.
Can you argue with somebody that doesn't exist?
Like, yes.
A fictional character? Or can you argue with someone who can't see you? For example, someone on television. Can you argue with yourself?
I argued with a squirrel.
Yes. Can you argue with, you can argue with a squirrel. You can argue with a crack in the sidewalk that you trip on. You can argue with a doorknob that, you know, it doesn't work. It doesn't take much to have an argument in terms of the number of people. It's really just, you can have one with yourself, and we will argue with anything, alive, dead, imaginary, fictional, historical, or otherwise. Okay, so what kinds of things tend to start arguments? What do you think is the thing that sparks it in the first place? There's one. So, you know, for example, you want something and someone says, no, you can't have it. That's like an example of the beginning of an argument where, you know, there's a difference between what someone wants and what they can have. What other kinds of things can spark a disagreement? How did your argument with the squirrel start?
He robbed our garden.
Oh, okay.
But I won the argument because he got caught in our neighbor's trap.
Oh, okay. Well, he lost that argument, I guess.
Yeah. He gave up. He said, I'm guilty.
He gave up. Yeah, so that's a case of, you know, the squirrel's behaving according to its own rules, and you're behaving according to your own expectations of what is appropriate in the garden, and those two things come into conflict, and there's an argument, and someone tries to right that wrong, right? And by trapping them, or by shooing them away, or changing the gate, you know, these kinds of things. I mean, good luck keeping a squirrel out of a garden, but you understand that, like, the difference, the conflict is, you both have very different mental models of the world, and one of you has more power than the other and can sort of enforce that through an argument. So how do they end? Like, when do arguments end?
Never.
Yes, actually, that's the right answer. They don't end, right? Because, like, no matter whether or not you got the squirrel didn't change its mind about whether or not it wanted to be in that garden. It might avoid you in the future, you know, or might, you know, never be able to go in the garden again if it's sent away or killed. But the actual argument itself, the thing that's like, I think this is the way it is and you think differently, that doesn't necessarily always end. That can last forever. And if you think about your best friends or your parents, you tend to have the same arguments over and over again in different forms, right? They pop up again and again. So I like to think of this as a reassuring thing, because you're not on the hook for figuring it out in a given moment. You don't have to solve this problem right now. Most of the time, the problem isn't solvable. What you can do is figure out, how do we exist together despite the disagreement, despite the fact that we see the world differently? Can we agree on how to relate to one another, how to, you know, do things together, even though I don't want to change my mind about it? So yeah, they don't end. Even when they officially end, someone wins, someone gets, you know, punished, or you know, gets what they want, or someone says they agree, their hearts might not have actually changed. They might have just conceded a defeat based on exhaustion, or, you know, the fact that they have less power. So given all that, what do they do for us? Like, why do we do this? Why do we even have these? Why argue with the squirrel? Why argue with, you know, your friends who aren't playing the games you want to play? Why argue with, you know, the sidewalk for tripping you? What's the goal? What do they do for us?
Nothing.
Can they do anything positive?
Give somebody a change of heart.
Yeah, that's one. Anything else that comes to mind? So here's an example with my son here, Louis. I'm gonna have some pictures of my kids here. He's 3. He loves putting his feet on the table. Of course, when you're eating lunch or dinner, you're not supposed to put your feet on the table, but he loves to do it. And the more I sort of chide him for it, the more he does it. What's actually happening there? What's he thinking this argument is about?
A game. It's a game.
Yeah. It's, how do I make my father sort of angry, or how do I make him, chide me for this? Like, or how do I do this enough times and see, like, where the limit is? Like, when does the emotion change from playfulness to anger? Sometimes it's just like, I want attention, right? I want to, you know, connect with you. And he's, you know, we're connecting in a way that is not, you know, is true. Like, is like, I feel closer to him just because we're playing this game. I don't really care a whole lot about the foot on the table thing, but, you know, it's a way to banter, I suppose. So that's one thing they do for us, is like, they allow us to sort of get into a rhythm of dialogue. They allow us to have fun with each other. They allow us to sort of see each other's boundaries, like where's the limit on different things. Sort of like dogs, you know, playing fight, right? Like, you get to see, like, you know, if I bite this hard, is it gonna hurt, or is it gonna, just be fun? So you get to experiment with things. What else can it do? They can be fun, right? They could be, if you're in an argument that ends up, you know, being about something silly, like, you know, should we have ice cream or should we have cake for dessert? There's a chance that even if you lose that argument, you're still gonna enjoy dessert, right? You're still gonna have fun with the result. So just to, I'll go into this a bit more, but like this is sort of how I like to frame disagreements. So like they can produce fruit. And ultimately, how do we get better at them so that that's more likely to happen? Oops, what am I doing here? Okay, so there are so many kinds of disagreements. These are all with my son. You see the one where Louis is not convinced of the house rules that they're deserving of being followed. There's always like the, you know, I don't want to go to bed. You know, I don't want to take a bath. I don't want to, you know, take a nap. I don't want to, whatever it is. Like those can be disagreements, right? Where it's like you resist the thing that you don't want to do. This one in the corner is from last week, where we were arguing about whether or not the training wheel should come off his bike, which was a really interesting argument because like I thought he'd only had them on for a week. If we took them off, then I'd have to put them back on, all this stuff. And he was adamant. He was like, I got to take them off. And so eventually we did. And 2 days later, he was riding without training wheels. So in that case, he knew something about himself that I didn't believe, and he proved me wrong. So this is another case where I learned something about him, and we got to that point by disagreeing. If he had said nothing, he just kept them on, I never would have learned that about him. All right, and we'll go through this a little bit faster. And there's also a lot of different people we can have disagreements with. You can imagine, we sort of went through a few of them, like, you know, our parents, our friends. Can you think of the most recent disagreement you've had or argument you've had? Like, who was it with?
Squirrel, yesterday. Squirrel.
Yeah, exactly. How about before that?
My brother.
What'd you argue about?
If we should play inside or outside.
Ooh, okay. Yeah. Any others that come to mind? Do you have any arguments with your parents? People that you don't know? I guess we don't see as many people we don't know these days, but you know, if you're at the store and someone cuts in line, you can have an argument with them. People at school, that are mean to you or tease you. These are all different ways that different groups of people, and we have different relationships with each of them. All right, so, and the last sort of dimension I'll bring up here is that you can imagine that each environment that we have them in creates a different power dynamic, right? So sometimes you're in a classroom, the teacher's sort of the one that has the authority, and the students have to listen, and so the teacher gets to make the rules and has more power. But then there's also, I don't know, you might not be on social media yet, but, you know, someone posts something and then people comment on them, and there's a dynamic between the different poster and the different people commenting, and they each have different relationships, both to the poster and to each other. There's also around the dinner table or the lunch table, and there's so many more. There's, you know, sitting in a park, or there's, you know, on each of these things, sometimes the disagreement will not work in one environment. And then if you move outside or you go for a walk or you change the setting, it'll work in a different environment. So it's always important to think about that. But ultimately, all these factors combined, it's just a big, you know, stew of factors that go into it. A misconception that we have about disagreements is that they're bad. We think that they are bad because they make us feel bad sometimes. They definitely involve strong emotions. They sometimes end up resulting in someone like unilateral, like sort of forcing a conclusion or forcing something to happen that you don't want to happen. But there are also good outcomes, like I mentioned with the bike thing, like where, you know, if he had not argued with me about this, he would have had less time, you know, on his new bike. So, and he wouldn't have shown me that he actually had learned this thing. So the good outcomes are things that I say generate fruit. They generate fruit, like, you know, in the case of the bike thing, like it was enjoyable. It's so enjoyable to see him like riding a bike, and like we feel closer to kid together. I've learned something about him. And sometimes it's just one or two fruit. Like maybe in the case of the foot one, like we get to invent our, you know, family etiquette and manners around the table. And we get to refine them and sort of challenge them and make them work. And sometimes there's none where everything is bad. It's not enjoyable. We feel less connected. We haven't learned anything. And, you know, those are the ones that we think of first of all when these happen, because they are, you know, those are the worst ones that stick in our minds. Okay, so discussion time. Let's pick a disagreement. It could be with a squirrel, it could be with something else, but think about a category of them, like a whole, like a category like where that you seem to have a lot. For example, you want to go or do something or get something, but you know your parents won't let you, or you and your friend get in an argument about something they said, and like maybe you misinterpreted them, or they said it, they said the wrong thing, and they can't take it back. Or you know, this happens a lot too, like where you get blamed for something you didn't do, and like you're trying to defend yourself and say like, no, this is, you misunderstood. How can I clear this up? Or you can come up with another one, but like, let's choose a category to sort of dive a little deeper into if you want. Anyone can suggest something too. Any stand out?
Some disagreements you can have just because there's nothing else to do when you're bored.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. What's an example? Like, so have you had one of these recently?
Yes, the one with the squirrel. It was because I was bored.
Okay.
And it served him right. It served
yes.
him right.
Yeah, so, okay. I like the squirrel. So let's go with that. So that's a case of, well, let's see. It could be many things. You could say... Yeah, you know, the way that you phrased it was, it's basically entertainment, right? You're choosing to have this disagreement with the squirrel because it's a little bit silly, but also, you know, you're trying to protect your yard, and there's this sort of mismatch between what's happening and what you want to happen. Let's do that. It's great. Okay. And maybe we'll come back and do one with another person just so we can have a two-sided disagreement. Is there anything that could go poorly in this disagreement? Let's say that, who else was it with you with the squirrel situation?
Just me.
Just you?
And my neighbors were watching.
Your neighbors were watching. Who had the trap?
Our across the street neighbors. So my next door neighbors were watching because they have kids. So their kids were watching. Their name, they're good friends of ours. And I was right at the edge of the road between, I was right at the edge, like a very small, narrow sidewalk between my neighbor's lawn and the street. I was standing on there, and I was arguing with the squirrel.
Mm-hmm. And had the squirrel already been trapped by that point?
Yeah. He was in the cage.
Okay. Okay. And what did the squirrel do? What was the squirrel's crime?
Violating property, trespassing, robbing gardens.
What did it steal?
Magnolia seeds, I think.
Okay. So it's like eating some of the
fruit.
Oh,
and tulip heads.
Tulip balls. Yeah. Okay, got it. That makes sense. Okay. So, and how did everyone feel the same way about the squirrel as you did?
I think. Yes. Well, my mom definitely felt the same way. Same with my brother. I'm not sure about my dad. He doesn't do much gardening, but my mom for sure.
Okay. And then did you have a discussion about what to do with the squirrel once you caught it?
I didn't catch it. My neighbor caught it.
Oh, okay. Do you know what happened to the squirrel?
No.
Okay.
I don't think he's right there today. But he was in there last night.
Okay. So in terms of, I know I argue with the weeds in my yard all the time, where, you know, they grow back and they keep on growing back, and I try to weed them out, but they keep on having like a little few bulbs in there. What do you think the chances are that a squirrel, or this squirrel will come back into your yard after this is done.
There's many different squirrels. I feel like they're a team because they're the only ones that come. Yeah. It's these two squirrels. One's gray, one's black, and one's brownish.
Yeah. So despite the disagreements, they don't seem to be listening. So that's something that can go poorly, is that you're having this argument. It's mostly, you know, obviously for entertainment and for fun, but also
one of them has stopped coming because me and my brother shoot them with water guns.
Ooh.
Okay, but the other, the black one, comes frequently, just not in the front yard where the garden is.
Uh-huh. Okay. So you got a whole family going on, and you've got multiple skirmishes throughout the days, right? Okay. And what would be like the best outcome that you could come up with for this scenario? For you.
The squirrels leave us alone. They find another food source. They go back to nuts. They stick to their nut diet.
Yes. Do they go to what if they go to your neighbor's yard instead of your yard?
Well, my neighbor and my mom are doing the garden thing together, so maybe two doors down.
Okay, two doors down. And then
that would be a better solution.
And then what if they send the squirrels back because they don't want the squirrels in their yard?
Then we'll shoot them with water guns.
The neighbors or the squirrels?
The squirrels.
Okay, this is awesome. Okay, so you can see that there's, you know, there's this sort of struggle happening where, like, you basically just want them gone. Would you miss them if they were gone at all?
Is very entertaining.
Okay, so there's part of it that is not really even about getting rid of them. It's about having an excuse to shoot them.
Yeah.
Okay, so a bad outcome could be that you get your way, right? You could win this one, and then all the fun's done.
I just wish that this argument could go on forever. It'd be very, very.
Well, you're lucky because that's generally how they go. So I think you're going to be okay with this one. So let's talk about this. Like, this is great because you can imagine actually being angry about this. And like, that's part of the performance of a disagreement. Just like, oh, stupid squirrel, get out of here. Or like, you can be genuinely sad that your tulip bulbs are being eaten, right? But on the plus side, you know, how could, you know, you've already spoken to enjoyment. Enjoyment is something that's already being sort of generated. So it's already fruitful in that sense. Security of the garden, yeah. You know, having tulips, you know, that can grow unhampered.
How about veggies and fruits?
Mm-hmm.
Fruits and veggies.
Do you feel like this actually brings you closer together with your neighbors at all?
No.
Is there any, like, I mean, if they're watching, why are they watching?
Wait, what do you mean if they're watching?
So you mentioned that the neighbors were watching sort of or at least they were there watching the squirrels or watching them. Were you shooting them? Something, they were like,
they were watching me. They were watching me give the squirrel a good long argument.
Uh-huh. And so did they find that entertaining?
They just stared at me. They didn't really speak. Said, Milo, don't go into that yard.
Awesome. I mean, I think it's safe to, like, I guess that they are somewhat entertained by it as well, because, you know, that it is entertaining. And you might actually learn something about how to protect your yard, how to, you know, keep the squirrels happy, but also, you know, in a way that's, you know, facilitates coexistence, you know, in the yard, since, you know, they are also citizens of nature and can come and go. But so there's all these opportunities to learn about, you know, things. There's all these opportunities to connect with your neighbors, potentially even connect with the squirrel in a sort of a adversarial role, and enjoy yourself. And let's ask this, like, is there anything you could change or do more of to make this more enjoyable, to make this more of a neighborhood sort of bonding experiment, to learn more about the yard, to learn more about plants that you have already? It seems like you've taken pretty good advantage of this, but I'm curious if anything else comes to mind.
Not really. It's really perfect the way it is. It would be kind of fun if all the squirrels came at once, not just one at a time.
Yeah.
Because so, my brother shoots them too. So we could both take a different side of the house.
Yeah, there's an interesting, you know, you sort of mentioned that you want the squirrels to come back, you know, but how would your parents feel or how would your neighbors feel if you fed the squirrels with things other than what's in the garden?
I wouldn't do that, but if I did do it, they'd feel weird because I have made war with the squirrels. So they would feel weird. I declared war with them a couple of days ago. So for them, it would feel weird that I'm actually feeding my enemies.
Sort of a conflict of interest, or sort of exposes the other ulterior motives for the war. Sometimes it's just the battle itself that's fun. You know, especially in quarantine time, right? Like we're at a loss for a lot of forms of entertainment. This is one of the ones that we can return to. I bet they would understand. I think it's, do you feel like you would be confused by this if you?
Yes, very.
What does
it? There was a part of me, if there was, but there isn't, that wanted to feed the squirrels, it would be like a millimeter by a millimeter part of me.
I see.
A millimeter so square.
A very small part of you that wants to do this.
Yes.
But what if you use this as an excuse to get them back onto the nut diet?
I could.
Then you're sort of getting what you want out of it too. You're sort of shifting them from the bulbs and the flowers and back onto a less, you know, threatening diet for your yard, I guess. And maybe they'll get so excited about these nuts that they'll start eating those entirely.
Mm-hmm.
So this is why I like these questions. Like in a disagreement where there's a glimmer of something that is sort of unexplored or that seems contradictory, those are oftentimes pieces of ourselves that could be really interesting to explore. If it's only a millimeter by a millimeter right now, it might be an inch by an inch. If you start asking these questions and like, well, what do I want from the squirrels? Is there any part of me that does like them, that does want them to thrive, if it can happen with these conditions? And you could find a common ground and both be entertained and be collaborative with your neighbors and with the animals in your yard. If you explore this, it's one avenue you can go. And in the art of disagreement, I think this is oftentimes the best route for getting out of a head-to-head battle, if it's really unenjoyable, is to find this common ground where you can say like, okay, well, there is something that we both have in common that we can both do together, but I don't quite understand that part of myself yet. And I sort of have to tease it apart and explore it myself. So we used a fun example here. You can imagine applying this to even more broader general conversations you have with people. Because the key thing to remember here is that a disagreement is always about something you care about, right? It's always about something that you value. In this case, it could be your garden. In the case of
pumpkins.
Your pumpkins, yes. It could be in the case of, arguing with your brother or sister about playing indoors or outdoors, it's about how you spend your time, how you have fun. It could be all these things that on the surface, it looks like you're just fighting and you're just angry, but under the surface, there's something that you value. And oftentimes the other person doesn't know that you value this thing. When you say like, I wanna go outside, it could be because you actually just really enjoy the sun on your skin, or you really enjoy the fresh air, or you really enjoy these things. And you could say, I really enjoy the fresh air. And that's less threatening than saying, let's play outside instead of inside, which is what you want to do. And this is the key, is like, let them know what you care about that is under the surface. And alternatively, the second thing is, try to find out what they care about. What is it about, you know, playing inside that, you know, that they really value? And use this as a way to tease apart parts of them that you don't quite see currently. And you get to learn about them, you get to ask them interesting questions, and you also get to shift the conversation from one that feels really yucky to one that feels more like inquisitive and curious and less bad, more enjoyable. So those are the two tips I would sort of take away from this. Is a disagreement happens, that means something that you care about is coming to the surface and feeling threatened. Look at that thing that feels threatened and ask yourself questions about it, and then try to find out what that thing is in the other person. Does that make sense?
Yes.
Okay, so I think, let's see, it's 10:06. How much time, how are we doing on time? I'm sort of lost track here.
We're good. We have just under, we have 25 minutes left.
Okay.
If you need it.
Yeah, so does anyone want to go through another example quickly that's with an argument, or do you want to go, or do you have questions you want to ask?
I have a question.
Okay.
Do you enjoy disagreements?
So yeah, that's a great question, because I actually do. I didn't always, and I'm 43 years old right now. I've probably spent 40 of my years less enjoying, like not enjoying them a whole lot. So, you know, I don't expect this to happen quickly or suddenly with you know, a single conversation. But there is, because I've learned to see a disagreement as this potential doorway into something I don't understand. I see it as like a portal to a mystery that I don't understand. It becomes a bit like a video game where you're like, how do I figure out what this mystery is all about? How do I figure out why we are having so much trouble seeing eye to eye? Like, what do I miss? What am I missing about your perspective? Of course, there are many things that I have no control over, right? Like, there's many arguments where, you know, like, you know, coronavirus is happening and I really want to go, you know, see my friends. And I might get angry at coronavirus for forcing this on me. I can explore, you know, I'm not going to resolve that necessarily. I'm not going to be able to see my friends, but I can explore, like, what do I miss about them? You know, and I can actually, are there any other ways I can reach out to them and connect with them during this time? And use that as a way to learn about myself. And then there's other times where, you know, something bad is happening where, you know, someone might be forcing you to, do chores or something, and you don't want to do it. You don't think it's fair. You think your brother gets way less than you do, so you might not, that it's not enjoyable to do the chores. So you sort of feel frustrated by that. But at the same time, you can start to, you know, if you can twist it to the point of like, ask your parents, like, or your, you know, siblings, like, how could I be more helpful in a way that, you know, I enjoy, you might be able to use this as a path to actually improving the chore system, and end up with a better system that is more, enjoyable for you. So I see it as this potential to make something better about the world. Yeah. Great question. Any others before we go on? Does anyone have another argument that they've had recently that they want to just like get a quick sort of read on using this framework? Does anyone, so my son, my 10-year-old, he just turned 10, and one of his arguments was, he wants to extend his bedtime. He wants, like, you know, he's waking up at the same time. We generally make him go to bed at 9. He's like, I'm 10 years old now. I should be able to stay up later. And this is a long campaign. It's been, you know, going for this for you know, months. So sometimes it goes poorly where, you know, if he's really tired, this is a bad time to have this conversation. But, you know, there's a chance to get something good out of it where you bring it up at dinner, you're bringing it up in sort of a less threatening environment and say like, okay, well, what time do you want to go to bed? You know, when I was a kid, my parents said, go to bed whenever you want. And you just have to deal with the consequences of being tired the next day. And so I could see the value in that too. But that's another argument where it's about, where are the boundaries? How can I show that I'm responsible enough to go to bed at the right time? How can I show that, I can handle my tiredness, or, you know, and at the same time, do what I want to do at night, and get that enjoyment as well. Do any of you have like arguments that are about bedtime or about sort of time spent doing things, playing video games, playing outside? What are the scarce things, like watching movies, eating popcorn, candy, dessert? There's a bunch. And you can see that each of these things is a disagreement that you can avoid and just like let the unhappy state drag on forever. Or you can use it as a way to like, how can I actually have this disagreement in a way that I get to potentially push my bedtime out, or potentially improve my, get more responsibility for playing outside by myself, or having more time, watching movies or whatever it is. If you do it in a way that's productive and that goes really well, you get to actually get those rewards as well. Have any of you successfully sort of negotiated new terms with your parents on these kinds of things? Salamander, I see your mic turned on. Okay, well, I'll move on. So let's sum this up. Disagreement is a skill, much like learning to ride a bike, much like learning to cook, much like learning to write or read. There's basically things you could do to make yourself a little bit better at them, but ultimately these are skills that take a lifetime to master. You'll never be an expert at this, but you can get better. The key is to realize that disagreements are about something you care about, and that you can use that as a doorway to figure out what you care about and why. The two tricks or the two tips I suggested were to share what you care about with the other person. Maybe they don't know this about you. You get to reveal something about yourself to them. And then also ask them what they care about. Maybe that's something that you don't understand or know about them. So you get to sort of slowly understand each other better. And the trick with disagreements is that you'll come up with sort of patterns and habits in this stuff that work for a while, and then they'll stop working. And the key is to always keep an eye on things. If they're not working, try something different, because it's the mystery of life that unfolds through disagreement is always going to evolve. And at some point, the tools that you develop will stop working, and it's time to pick up new tools. And being curious and open to that and trying different things is really important. But one of the stereotypes that, as you grow older, I grow older, we tend to get sort of stuck in our ways. We tend to do things and want things a certain way and do it over and over again. Obviously, that's not a very well adapted strategy here. It's always good to try something different when it's not working. And disagreement is the perfect sort of environment to bring that skill to. So those are my thoughts on disagreement. I really enjoyed the squirrel battle. I wish I could, hear about the narrative going forward with that, because I could see this being a multi-season disagreement that you're having with them. So and I'm open to questions and any thoughts you have. Like, do you feel like, are you convinced that disagreements are a tool to make your life better, or are you still skeptical? I'm open to that. Or anything else you have?
I think that was awesome.
Cool.
Me as well.
Me as well.
Thank you. Yeah, thank you for having me, on your class. And, good luck with this in the future. Give yourself some leeway to make mistakes when you first start trying to use this, these skills. It's always going to go wrong sometimes, and you just got to find your stride. But I think kids are like, you're already so curious about the world, and we only develop bad habits, going forward. So the more you can use this to avoid developing bad habits, the better your advantage is later in life to just be someone that can like navigate through these disagreements with glee and excitement and getting the best out of it and out of other people. It'll really give you a huge advantage in life. So I wish you luck.
Absolutely. I think this is extremely, extremely valuable information, especially for these guys. So thank you so much.
Awesome. Yeah. Thanks for asking great questions and thanks for having me.